history of American music education. The majority of American music education emerged from the British settlements into New England. These colonists arrived in two waves, in 1620 and 1630. Both groups left England during the Reformation to seek religious freedom. Although singing was encouraged by the congregation during services, education in music performance was often left to the clergy. The purpose of this little video is to give some information of one clergyman, Martin Luther, whose hymns not only influenced the development of singing by the congregation in churches, but also had an influence on the sacred music of Baroque composers such as J.S. Bach. Before I go into the discussion of Martin Luther's music, let me give you a brief overview of Martin Luther himself. Martin Luther was born on November 10, 1483, to parents Hans and Marguerite, and was baptized Catholic, as was customary then. His family moved to Mansfield in 1484, where his father was a leaseholder and council representative. Because Hans Luther was a very ambitious man, both for himself and his family, he pushed Martin to become a lawyer. Martin attended Latin schools in Mansfield, Magdeburg, and Eisenach, where he learned religion, rhetoric, and logic. He lovingly referred to these times as purgatory and hell. Then at the age of 19, Luther attended the University of Erfurt, where he received his master's degree. Out of duty to his father, Luther enrolled in law school, but immediately dropped out because he believed law represented uncertainty. He became interested in theology and philosophy, especially the words of Aristotle, but later drew away from such ideas because it taught about reason and free thinking, but not about loving God, which he felt was more important. Because of these convictions, scripture became his most important tool. One source tells a story of how in July of 1505, Martin Luther was almost struck by lightning, and he cried out to St. Anna for help, promising to be a monk if help came. Afterwards, he sold his books and entered a closed Augustinian friary in Erfurt, much to his father's disapproval. While there, he was ordained as a priest and began teaching theology at the University of Wittenberg. He received a Doctor of Theology and even became a senate of the faculty there. He spent the rest of his career there. Just 5 years later, he began the events that led to the Protestant Reformation. When he confronted indulgent salesman John Tetzel by posting his 95 Theses. His refusal to retract his writings at the Diet of Worms in 1520 led to his excommunication by the Pope Leo X. He went on to challenge the teachings of the Catholic Church and created his own Lutheran doctrine. He also translated the Bible in the vernacular of his followers, which was German, adding some of his new principles. During this Reformation, Martin Luther became modifying the new church practices. One such change was to allow clergy to marry. Luther himself married a nun named Katharina von Bora in 1523. Luther also wrote a German Mass in 1526 for the simple people to be able to understand so that they may believe and become Christians. Of course, one of the most influential changes of his Mass, as it pertains to this class at least, was the inclusion of congregational singing of hymns and psalms in German, as well as parts of the liturgy, such as the Creed. Luther himself was a successful
on earth is now.
forward to George Rao's collection of Symphonie Inconnue, he said, "I, Dr. Martin Luther, wish all lovers of the unshackled art of music grace and peace from God the Father and from our Lord Jesus Christ. I truly desire that all Christians would love and regard as worthy the lovely gift of music, which is a precious, worthy, and costly treasure given to mankind by God. The riches of music are so excellent and so precious that words fail me whenever I attempt to discuss and describe them. In summa, next to the Word of God, the noble art of music is the greatest treasure in the world. It controls our thoughts, minds, hearts, and spirits. Our dear fathers and prophets did not desire, without reason, that music be always used in the churches. Hence, we have so many songs and psalms. This precious gift has been given to man alone, that he might thereby remind himself that God has created man for the express purpose of praising and extolling God. However, when man's natural musical ability is whetted and polished to the extent that it becomes an art, then do we note with great surprise the great and perfect wisdom of God in music, which is, after all, his product and his gift. We marvel when we hear music in which one voice sings a simple melody, while three, four, or five other voices play and trip lustily around the voice that sings its simple melody and adorn this simple melody wonderfully with artistic musical effects, thus reminding us of a heavenly dance, where all meet in a spirit of friendliness, caress, and embrace. A person who gives this some thought and yet does not regard music as a marvelous creation of God must be a clodhopper indeed and does not deserve to be called a human being. He should be permitted to hear nothing but the braying of asses and the grunting of hogs." Martin Luther's beliefs in congregational hymns can only be assumed to have had an impact on the sacred music of J.S. Bach. The usual form of Bach's cantatas are that it will play a simple hymn melody, and then expand on it through fugues and counterpoint, and then end with all three or four stanzas of the hymn in its original form so that the congregation can join in singing.